So when we look at protein coding sequences, we refer to the amino acid coding sequence. Look at the DNA, DNA gene or gene coding sequence, which will result in a protein coding region. So when we do synthetic biology, generally we can fuse two or more different domains to achieve a new function. For instance, if you have an enzyme which has function A and function B, you can fuse these two enzymes and obtain a new enzyme with a new function. Okay, that's what happens in viral polyproteins. If you recall, last time I mentioned briefly about virus and their proteins, they are polyprotein. So viruses are very innovative. They have to package their whole genome in a very small space, which is inside the capsid. So what they do, they have their proteins are generally coded on a single DNA fragment, so RNA fragment. So this will be a polyprotein. Now, when the virus expresses this protein or translates it in the cell inside the cell, it will actually cleave the protein using an enzyme which is present in the cell itself. For instance, a virus with a polyprotein, which is an RNA virus, invades your cell. Once it's in your cell, the RNA gets translated into protein. But this protein is multifunctional, so it does not work as it is. So maybe your cell contains an enzyme, and that enzyme can cleave this viral protein. So the viral machinery uses your cellular machinery to cleave this protein. So this is very common in viruses. They have one protein which is multiple function. It's called a polyprotein. Now, researchers in synthetic biology have studied this pattern which occurs in nature, and they have applied it to develop synthetic molecules which are multifunction. So you can fuse two proteins together. For instance, I'll give you an example. You have a cancer cell in your body. You want to have a protein which is going to target cancer cell and which will destroy cancer cell. Okay? So you can fuse a peptide which will be a signal peptide. Okay? So this signal peptide will only seek to cancer cell and bind to cancer cell based on a specific receptor molecule. And then the second part of the protein may be a toxin which will kill the cancer cell once it enters into it. So this is the way in which you create fusion proteins. One of the most commonly used fusion is green fluorescent protein. So GFP is fused to many proteins to enhance the resolution. For instance, in microscopy, you can fuse the GFP to an antibody or fuse it to antigen. And then you have a mixture of cells. Some are, for example, cancer cells, some are brain cells, some are neural cells. You can make them target the receptor. And then if you look under the fluorescence microscope, you can sort out the cells. So this is has wide-ranging applications. If you can see our fluorescent activity cell sorter, we have a cell sorter in the lab which will sort the cells. Okay, you can give a mixture. For instance, in your blood, there will be a lot of circulating cells. You can extract all the cells, and then you can tag them with protein using a fusion fluorescent protein. Insert them into our cell sorter, and the cell sorter will sort out the cell based on their fluorescence. Okay. So these have a lot of applications when you do protein fusion for construction of new proteins. Okay, and these are the terminators. So terminators are located at the end of the sequence. So a terminator actually forms a loop which will prevent the ribosome from moving forward. So you have row-dependent and row-independent terminators. So this is an example of a row-dependent terminator. So that hepane actually represents the Greek letter rho, which is why it's called rho-dependent terminator. A rho-independent terminator will consist of a sequence which is recognized by the ribosome as the end of the transcript. It won't go forward. So you have rho-dependent, rho-independent. Rho-dependent, you can identify them because of the palindromic sequence. Can you view the palindromic sequence? They are inverted sequences, so definitely they will have a base pairing in the RNA. Whereas the row-independent will not have palindromic sequence. They will have a sequence which is recognized by the ribosome as the end of translation. So the ribosome will leave let go of the RNA at that point. Okay, so terminators are available in the parts registry. Because they are larger, it's better to buy them as biobrick and assemble them rather than to use them to synthesize them using PCR or oligonucleotide probes. Okay, so as I told you, composite parts is when you combine one or more parts, you combine an RBS and a gene and you create a composite part, and then you make a part into a device. Okay. So coming down to joining things, okay, together. Now that you know about paths, you need to know how they are joined together. There are two ways to do it. One is by using a procedure known as Gibson assembly, which is developed by Dan Gibson, also from the J. Craig Venter Institute, JCVI. And the second one is assembly PCR. Usually we revert to Gibson assembly, it's very efficient. So Gibson assembly is unique in the sense that it uses a ligase, which is thermostable. The ligase which we use in the lab is not thermostable. It functions best at 15 degrees. So we have a ligase. So that's why they say when you do cloning, when you want to do a ligation step, keep it in the cold, or put it on ice, or keep it in the fridge. It functions best at low temperature. Gibson assembly uses a ligase which is thermostable and which is has proofreading activity. Because in a gene, if you miss out on a single nucleotide, you will get scars, a gene scar. If you have a scar in the gene, a scar refers to an insertion of a single nucleotide, an indel, insertion or deletion. If you have a scar in your gene, you will have no expression because your open reading frame will be disrupted. Do you know the rule for open reading frame? How do you define the open reading frame? How do you detect?
You divide it
and you get a whole number and then you get your open reading frame. Right, I think. So these are the three enzymes, T5 exonuclease, TEC ligase and fusion polymerase. So I've developed an animation for you in YouTube, which you can refer to later. So the fusion polymerase is actually a DNA polymerase, which is high fidelity, which means it has proofreading capability and it has DNA polymerase activity from 5 prime to 3 prime and proofreading activity from 3 prime to 5 prime. It's clear about the orientation of a gene. So 5 prime means you move from this way, so 5 prime to 3 prime. So when it wants to synthesize, it synthesizes like this. But it also checks itself. So this is like an accountant and an auditor. The accountant prepares your account, but the auditor will cross check. So this is an accountant and auditor combined in one. So in the human system, the accountant and auditor is always separate because they need to cross-check. In nature, it functions together. The proofreading polymerase will actually read through and it will actually check for its own errors. It's a self-critical enzyme. It has self-critical function. Okay, so you have an exonuclease. Exonuclease is basically degrade DNA. However, this is a T5 exonuclease. It won't degrade all DNA. Slowly degrade it in a specific manner, which I will demonstrate for you. And you have the TEC ligase. So these three enzymes are required for Gibson assembly. I will show you how it's done in a step-by-step manner. Okay, this is an overview of the procedure, but we'll go into it step-by-step. So the red and the green represent two PCR products. You want to assemble them together. So in order to assemble them together, before you do an assembly, you need to create an overlapping fragment. For instance, the blue, right, represents an overlapping fragment. So that overlapping fragment can be up to 40 bases long. So if you have an overlapping fragment, it means that the 5' end of the red fragment and the 3' end of the green fragment should be overlapping. Okay, so when you design your product, PCR product, you can't take any two PCR products and join them together. It won't work. You need to have the overlap. Okay, so you have the overlapping region in blue. So how do you do that? When you design your primer sequence, you have to include that fragment, the overlapping sequence in the primer design. When we do the bioinformatics, I will teach you how to design primer for this assembly. The first step of the enzyme procedure involves the enzyme P5 exonuclease. P5 exonuclease will chew back or eat back at the DNA in a specific way. So it will chew back at the 5' and 3' ends. A normal DNA will chew back all the DNA. It will consume everything and it will have just nucleotides after fragmentation. T5 is very specific. It will chew back at the 5 prime and 3 prime. However, it will leave one of the strands intact. And you see it's how it functions. It actually chews back at this end and that end. At that end and that end. So you have two fragments which actually have overlap. Okay, so you have put in the overlap. The yellow represents the overlap. The small yellow section represents the overlap. Now comes the next step. So in the step 2 of Gibson assembly, ligase will join both the fragment wherever there's an overlap. So ligase C5. So the first one is exonuclease, second one is ligase. Okay, when the ligase joined, it joined based on the base pairing. But can you see the gaps? So you need to fill in the gaps. How will you fill in the gaps?
Polymerase.
You need a polymerase. So exonucleases will degrade, ligases will join, and polymerases will repair. Can you recall which is the polymerase we use for reverse transcription?
Clinofragment.
Clinofragment, correct. That's correct. So clinofragment is the one which we use for repair of nicks and gaps. This one is used to repair large gaps. So you have your polymerase, which is your fusion polymerase. So the fusion polymerase will repair the gaps. So it's just three steps. Exonuclease, ligase, polymerase. So you have three steps and you'll have your intact molecule. So this will repair the 5' end and the 3' end. There is no overlap at those ends. However, because of the activity of T5 exonuclease, they have been chewed or eaten, degraded in that manner. Okay, this is now your gene construct. So you have your gene construct. What will you do with it next? So it's ready for downstream processing. You can clone it, you can express it, you can insert it into plasmids. So you have, so in this case, right, the green may represent the promoter. The red can represent the gene assembly. So you have your gene RPS. So this is just an example of how you fuse two DNA molecules together. The green and the red may be any molecule. They may be a promoter binding site and a gene coding region. They may represent RPS and a gene coding region, or they can represent two genes which are fused together. The good thing about Gibson assembly, it does not create gaps in the ORF. It always ensures that the ORF is intact. So you'll have expression of the protein. Now, usually it's supplied in the format of a kit. So you get all the components together as one kit. This is one of the other ways in which you assemble DNA. So, in the earlier days, before the advent of synthetic biology and the synthetic oligonucleotide, you could actually use this program. This is called gene to oligo. You can access it in your system online. And this gene to oligo, all you need to do is to insert your DNA sequence into the software. What it will do, it will go through your sequence, and it will produce a series of nucleotides. Okay, so you have, for instance, I will give you an example. So what it will do is, it takes your gene of interest, which is an input sequence, and it generates a lot of small oligos. Okay. In the earlier days, there was no gene synthesis. We could only the maximum length of the primer was 30 bases. So they used this software to generate those oligos. So once you have you upload your sequence, you obtain the oligonucleotides, and then you used to mix all the oligonucleotides in the PCR tube like a jigsaw puzzle, and we used to try and do a PCR. So in many cases, it should not work. So this is the earlier technique, but you can still do it for small genes. You use the gene to oligo up to 300 nucleotides, you can assemble genes very well, because it will save you a lot of money, because if you have a 300 base pair sequence, you can actually synthesize small oligo of 30, 30, 30. You can put it in a PCR tube, you adopt this procedure, and you will get your synthetic gene construct. However, don't try it beyond 500 bases, because then you'll have, you know what happens, right? It's a jigsaw puzzle. You may have lots of combinations, and you'll have lots of iteration, and things will end up with no proper ORF. Okay, so this is used to upload our sequence. We get different oligos, These are the oligo, it says. So we synthesize all these oligos and then we join them together. And then this is our reaction mixture and we obtain our product. Okay. So this is assembly PCR. So you can also use ligase chain reaction to assemble. But these are earlier techniques. I just revealed them to you because I need you to understand that earlier it was very difficult to do synthetic biology because there are limitations in the gene synthesis. Today you can go up to 20,000 bases with no difficulty at all. However, it will cost you, because as the size of the gene increase, the cost will increase exponentially. Okay, so you go in for the, then once you have your gene, you follow your same protocol, you go in for gene cloning and expression, and finally you express your protein. So today's lecture is focused primarily on synthetic biology. And you should be aware of synthetic biology because it's an emerging field. And there are two aspects in terms of your course. One of it is IP. So when you create synthetic molecules, you have an access to intellectual property filing. Okay, so you can file it, file for IP. So a lot of products have been created using this approach. For instance, your RNA polymerase or DNA polymerase, we have different brands. Most of them are synthetic. Because what they have done, they have taken the original DNA polymerase molecule and they tweak it, they adjust certain nucleotide sequences, they change amino acid sequences and then they create new molecules. So these molecules are more efficient. For instance, earlier there was a rule of the thumb, whenever we use DNA polymerase, for 1 minute extension we got 1 kb. Yeah. So if our gene was 2 kb, we did 2. Nowadays with the new polymerase, you don't need extension time is 10 seconds. How did they modify it? They modified the DNA polymerase. They created a DNA polymerase which will do a job of 16 minutes in 10 seconds. So you don't have 10 second extension time. So the other ones are also the fusion polymerases, where they created polymerases which have multiple functions at different temperatures. So let's move. So in order to understand synthetic biology and explore it fully, you need to access the parts registry. Okay, the parts registry is a database which contains a repository of parts. And you join parts together, you create new components. Okay, and then the third aspect of synthetic biology which you should be cognizant of is Gibson assembly and assembly PCR. So Gibson assembly is a technique which is used by synthetic biologists to assemble genes. In fact, if you Google the Gibson assembly paper in Google Scholar, you'll find it's one of the most highly cited papers. Okay, so that brings us to the end of this lecture on synthetic biology.